I think that there are too many bored Christians, and nobody should be bored, because actually life with him is so enjoyable. God is the most amazing best friend anybody could ever have, and he's always got something new and incredibly creative for people.
Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of the Irish Green Room. It's on the wall.
It's a good thing, because I don't know where I am.
Are we going to make it? You're in the basement of the big house.
I can never get elevated. I don't know what's happening. No. Why am I always in the basement?
It's the humble place. Really, we got to read the Beatitudes. Welcome back, everybody. I'm here with Joanne Moody.
Hey, everybody.
Who's a long-term friend.
Long-lost friend.
Lost?
Yeah.
Someday. No, found.
Okay. Yeah. I'm so happy about that.
long friend. Love Joanne. And thank you for coming and doing this, hanging out with us. Just really quick, I'm going to ask the questions here. Okay. So, because I know the way you like to twist this.
Is there none on this end of the table?
Get out of here. When you have your own podcast, I can.
Could you switch places with me?
No. Okay. Either side. I'm still asking the questions. I like to, this is my side right now.
All right. I see that.
But we can flip it later.
Okay.
Cool. I'll let you ask me maybe a question later.
Gosh, I'm feeling grace.
We're gonna get into this. We're gonna figure this thing out.
Go for it.
Fix
all the world's problems.
I don't know about that.
In 45 minutes.
Maybe. I mean, I was told to fix some of yours during this podcast.
Really, please, Jesus. All right.
He says.
Did he say? I've sent you help her.
Yes.
Help her. I'm really grateful.
Here I am.
That is the answer.
Your service.
You're the answer to somebody's prayers. I'm not sure.
Oh, are we gonna get through this?
Go, dude. Go.
Joanne Moody.
Will Hart.
How old were you when you started Moody?
I thought you were going to ask me how old I was now.
No. Okay. No. How old were you when you started Moody? Moody Bible Institute.
I was 12.
Good. Wow. Yeah. No, you're no relation to the Moody's.
No. Oh, I wish.
Really?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. It
would give me some credibility in certain camps.
It would.
You know what I mean? Yeah. But no, we are not.
No?
No.
Okay. So for those of you who have, for those watching who have no idea
who you are.
Which I think is just weird to say.
I'm Will's neighbor. That's really
We're really good friends. I'll tell you who I know you as. You're Auntie Joe.
Yes.
At least to my kids.
Yes.
And you travel the world. You itinerate. You preach. You teach. You edify. You clarify. You mystify.
Gosh, and, I love that you got my resume.
Yep. And you're an author. You're a speaker. And you're all
and
around
a partridge
amazing.
In a pear tree. Yeah.
It's not Christmas anymore, Joe. It's March.
I really want it to be Christmas.
I'm going to give the 1 minute version of what I know. And then I want to hear from you about this, but you really, from what I know, you got thrust into ministry about 8 years ago.
Yes. It was not on my top 10 list. It's almost 10 years now. And
it's 10 already?
It's almost 10. Wow. Yeah. This August will be 10.
Okay.
Not that I'm counting, but I am.
And long story short, VOA, you were at VOA.
Yep.
As
2013.
And you were sick.
Mm-hmm. Really sick.
Really, really sick.
Yeah.
And you got prayed for by a guy named Richard Holcomb.
Yep. Our good friend.
Good friend.
Mm-hmm.
And everything changed in that moment. And
crazy.
You went right into it? Right into full-time ministry?
Well, you know, I mean, after suffering for almost 15 years and never seeing any power of God in the church, I got hit with the power of God and found Jesus in a way that I never knew him. And so from that moment, what do you do with your life? You know, do you go, oh, I think I'll go back to being an administrator at a church? No, you don't. You go, whatever you want to do with my life, Jesus. And that's what I did. And immediately had an unction to sign up for Randy Clark Schools Online.
Yep.
So did that. And then everything that I learned, as soon as I got back, the prophetic gifting was so crazy and I couldn't ignore it. I mean, I felt like, okay, this is God. This is the real deal.
Yeah.
And I would know things about people. I would walk down the halls of the church and I was completely healed and people were looking at me like, how is this possible? And I would just walk by and say, do you have a torn rotator cuff or things like that, words of knowledge. And these people would look at me, it's a Baptist church, and they would be like, what? And and I would just say, can I just pray for you? And they would go, I'm on the list, you know.
Like you know, the prayer list.
Which we never saw any healing in 13 years, by the way. But I would be like,
so you were at your church, like for, as an administrator.
Yeah, but always in pain, chronic chronic, insufferable, 24/7 nerve pain.
What was the name of the sickness?
Pudendal nerve entrapment.
That's the one. Yes. It was on the tip of my tongue.
It's everyday language for some people. Yeah. Yeah, it's a horrible thing. And it's in your pelvis. It's crushed nerves in your pelvis. So being dramatically complete, I'm a medical miracle. After that, just going back and trying to do what I had seen at VOA and having the door slammed in my face, not only was I not allowed to tell my testimony in my own church of 5,000 people, when I was going around just laying hands on people and they were getting healed left and right, we had 8 cases of advanced cancer in just the first 3 months of coming back from VOA. And I'm watching the Lord do these things. And I was like, and his own church is shutting the doors on him. So
you said you had 8 cases, were they 8 cases healed?
Or yes. Just eight cases healed.
Incredible.
But it was, I had all the keys to all the rooms of the church, you know, at that time in history. And so I just unlocked all of the doors of the church that were these little rooms that were supposed to be prayer rooms, but nobody ever used them, because we didn't really pray there. And I just taught everybody that got healed. They kept following me around going, well, I just want to do this. This is like crazy. I've never heard of anything like this. And I would teach them what I learned in the schools of Randy Clark. And as I taught them, they became this little band of people. And so I was forbidden to pray for anybody after a number of months. And so I just opened up all the doors and let all these people go in.
What did that conversation look like? Seriously,
I'll just do the mild one. Yeah. The mild version was
you're seeing healings and they're like, hey, stop.
Yeah. So the senior pastor, who was one of my dearest friends and is the person I worked for, was really in on it all in the beginning, but then the minute that the elders turned against him, he wanted to shut it all down. So what that looks like is you have very, very conservative Baptist rooted Dallas Theological Seminary graduates who are like, this is not God, this is witchcraft. You know, before I got healed, they loved me. I was the person who could do no wrong. And now that I got healed and I'm trying to just do what God says, I'm full of witchcraft. So it just became a splitting point where the dialogue was, we don't believe what you're doing is God. And so you are not going to pray, because every time you do pray, the senior pastor has an anxiety attack. So they said that they blamed me for his anxiety, which he has suffered from since he was 7 when his dad left. So I was learning all about trauma. I was learning all about root issues. And I was like, well, I can tell you, you could get healed of that. But it just became a very difficult place to be. But the Lord left me there for 2 years until my own attitude thawed out and I got healed.
Yeah.
Of some internal stuff. Once that happened, then he released me.
It's funny. I mean, you've seen it, right? As you travel, right?
Yeah.
Because God moves. He answers these prayers that are affecting people's lives. And then it gets called the enemy.
It's so crazy.
I've had some similar experiences myself early on. Like when I first started ministry, some similar experiences. It messes with you.
It just shocks you.
Yeah. Because you find I'm alive. Like, I love the Lord more than ever.
And it's all of who he is that we don't understand.
Yeah.
And so when we don't understand it, we go like this.
Right.
Don't come near me.
I wrestle with it, but I think at the end of the day, the Lord loves, he puts pastors in charge, right? The Lord puts pastors in place and they're doing the best that they can.
Yeah. I love the church.
Yeah. It's just so funny.
Be careful what you pray for, right? Because you're praying, you know, in so many churches, they're praying, you know, God, don't pass us by, come. And then he comes in a way that we don't understand. And then they go, this isn't God. It's a tragedy. But then, you know, what I would say today about all of those things that I endured and experienced, and I'm glad, I'm grateful, because everywhere that I go in the world where I encounter that, I know what that is.
Right.
And I don't judge anymore. I had a really hard time with the justice part of it all. You know, I remember saying some not so nice things. I know that's shocking and very hard to believe.
From you? No, I'm just kidding.
I said to the elder board that they would rather me lay on the ground and suffer than to have been healed the way that I did, because that really was what it came down to. And when I said that, I thought, wow, you know, in my heart was so much bitterness against them, because truly they would rather, it was easier to watch me suffer, because that was understandable, because we had this redemptive suffering gospel. where your suffering is somehow earning you something. Because they all used to quote when Jesus said, you know, in the garden, can you take this, you know, Father, take this cup from me. And I was like, that doesn't mean healing. That's not about physical healing. So we, and because at that time I didn't have a degree in theology, I couldn't, you know, I was like, and we didn't have women ministers, and it was just a lot.
You kind of hit it on all fronts.
Well, it was good training, you know, honestly. I mean, I hated it at the time. But I'm super grateful for the experience. Yeah. And I will say this, every one of those elders that did not leave the church, we had 40% of them leave after a while because the Holy Spirit wasn't going away. I mean, he just kept moving. Mm. I mean, we were seeing hundreds and hundreds of people healed. It just, and now all these people, how are you going to stop them? I mean, there's now 38 of them following me around, and they're going to the church on a Sunday morning at 6 o'clock, and Friday we had 3 services on a Friday. I mean, not Friday, but Saturday, 4 and 5:30 and 7:30 or something like that. Yeah. And they would go in before all those services and they would pray for people. So now there's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people are getting healed over months. And so you can't shut it down. So some elders left, but since then, and even just last year, I have gotten texts from all of them apologizing to me. And they apologized to me physically in person before I left.
Wow.
And they said, we drove you out of here. I said, oh no, you didn't. God's moving me on. But each one over the last, you know, 9 years, they've sent me text and said, God has really dealt with me on my issues and why I came so vehemently against you. And I'm really grateful that you didn't listen to me.
What would you do different if you had to do it all over again? I think about this a lot because I feel like I even made a bunch of enemies in my zeal.
Yeah, right? I think I
would. You do anything different?
Yeah, totally. I wouldn't have told so many people how angry I was. I think I spread a lot of poison. I wouldn't have. I was so horrified by the way they came at me. I was so shocked that they didn't want God in the way that he wanted them to experience him. So I was offended for God, which was so immature. I mean, at my age, I didn't understand why anyone would do that. And I also couldn't understand the hardness of heart. I think I would have kept my mouth shut more, and I would have probably sought, I mean, I did. I spoke to Randy about it. I spoke to Rodney Hoag about it. Yeah. But I think I probably would have gotten more help for me on the emotional front. Because it was a tragedy. I mean, my husband and I served in that church for 13 years. They knew our character.
Yeah.
And I think that assault against me on top of having suffered for almost 15 years was just a lot.
It's funny, like, you see people going through marriage stuff, and the church embraces it, like marriage difficulties or, you know, family difficulties, and the church embrace it. But as soon as the miraculous comes in, man, it really can be polarizing. I wish it wasn't so, but I the same thing that you're sharing, I experienced the same thing where.
What would you do different?
I was so zealous.
You would just not say as much?
Well, I was young, right? I was 17. So I remember getting saved going back on a Sunday morning. So it was like Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Yeah.
Sunday morning. It was either that next Sunday or the following Sunday. I was like, he's real. Oh my God. All I want is him.
Yeah.
You guys, why aren't you like doing that? Like, and I think it's natural, right? In your youth and in your zeal to go all in.
Right.
But I do remember, and I don't say this in a mean way. Everyone that I had talked to during that time, I love passionate. Like these guys are my family. I love them. But I remember going in and one of the pastors was like, hey, you had a mountaintop experience. Right.
But life's not like that.
Yeah. He says, when you come back down, come and talk to me and I'll tell you what it is to walk a Christian life, like a normal Christian life. And he gave me a book and it was like, Know Why You Believe or something like that. It was a good book. I read it and it was like the facts on, you know, the historical and scientific facts that prove God. And I don't know. I still, every time I see him, I go like, I'm burning, man. And the same thing that happened with you, like a lot of people apologized. A lot of people came back. Not that a ton of people offended me. Nobody owed me an apology. But it's just funny how God in The Miraculous is so divisive. For me, I watched Francis Chan go through his thing, and I was like, if it can happen to Francis, it can happen to anyone, where he experienced a miracle and was like, I can't go back. This is real.
And
this
his elder board, they're just an amazing group of young guys. And they came to ask me a question at a conference I was doing in the Bay Area.
You just shared this. Fill me in. I had never heard this.
It's a crazy story. We had a gal on our team who was on Francis's leadership team. She helped lead the women. She also was an administrator for Francis, and she worked with Kevin, his administrator, over Crazy Love Ministries. And I was doing a thing in the Bay, and she was there, and she said, Joe, I would never ask you this, but the elders, Francis's elders, really want to come down here and ask you something on a break. And I was like, well, that's really weird timing. She goes, please. So they came, and they shared a story with me of something that confounded them, that what they did was something biblical. They did it biblically, and it didn't work. And they were horrified.
Can you share what it is now? It's fine. It was a part of
Commission. Yeah, just say it's James in James 1:5. When you are bringing to the you're bringing the sick person to the elders, and they are praying, and that's what the word says. But when you don't operate in the gifts, and that your understanding of that is in a narrow margin, right? Would you say so? That their understanding, they had much more of a Calvinist position at that time, and this is almost 4 years ago. And they said, we did what the Bible said. And they had spoken to Bree, I guess, the gal that was on our team or is on our team. And she said, well, you should talk to Joe. And so that was how this whole thing came about. And so they came down, and I literally had 45 minutes, and I had to go back out and preach. And we're in the back room in a green room, and they're telling me the story, and they're asking me this question. And I said, well, I don't think the guy was saved. And they said, huh, that's what Francis said. And I said, well, I get it. You guys are totally traumatized when the person went out and did what they did, which I really can't say. But I said, Lord, I literally have 40 minutes left or 30 minutes left or whatever it is. What do you want me to do? And he said, ask them if they don't believe that the gifts are for today, and they don't believe that any Christians can have any demonic oppression, because their understanding is, you know, salvation, it's a clean house, it's a done deal. And this was the issue. They said this guy was saved, then he went out and did this heinous thing.
Right.
And so how could that be that he did that thing which is completely demonic? That couldn't be. So I said, I don't think he was saved, but that doesn't matter, because, you know, the Christians can be oppressed by demons. So that just went like set off a nerve, right?
Yeah.
And they're like, that's not true biblically, blah, blah, blah. So the Lord really impressed on me and said, just ask them, just say these words. Okay, so if you guys believe that Christians can't be oppressed by demons, is there nothing that any of you are afraid of, like deep fear? What a weird question. But I heard the Holy Spirit, so I asked that. And one of their elders starts to manifest, like, and gets like completely out of, like, angry, and starts saying different things. And I adore this guy, but I'm looking at him. And I go, hey, do you think that your response right now to my question is disproportionate, your reaction to my question? And he suddenly goes, what? Like, he's back. And I said, do you want to talk about that? And all of the elders, you know, they all lean in and they're looking at him like, what in the world was that? Because it was obvious this didn't make sense. His reaction was completely out of left field. It was very hostile, and it was very aggressive and emotional, and his upper lip started sweating. And so ended up taking him in front of all of his buddies, taking him through deliverance. He had been held at knife point, and he had been accused of something that didn't happen. He came out of the gangs, but he didn't do this particular thing. So this was a big trauma issue for him. And whenever he was around certain things, he would trigger and manifest. And so once the Lord cleaned him up, it was the most peaceful, beautiful thing. And they were wrecked. They were like, we didn't know. Yeah. So I invited them to a small group at my house. They came. And over the next 2 years, Francis and Lisa were so gracious and kept inviting me to come back and train them. So we trained their house church leaders. We trained all their elders. And Lisa was at every one of those trainings. And Francis tried to come so many times, and he couldn't because he was doing a million things. But Kevin was there, all his elders were there, and then all of his church leaders. So it was a really beautiful partnership and very honoring for us to be able to do some of that work with his churches and for him to trust that. He filmed every single training, and then he watched them.
Wow.
So that he could go through theologically what was happening. So it was a really amazing time to be able to go and do that.
So you went from being a church administrator to now preaching and dabbling in this stuff that is really confusing.
To a lot of
the church, right?
Yeah.
And how did you navigate growing in that? Did you put yourself on a fast track? Did you go to school?
So I did Randy's online program. He has a 3.5 year called Christian Healing Certification Program.
Yep.
And I had done a Baptist seminary. I had done an introductory program that they had. It was a master's program. It was 2.5 years about coaching. Because this is such a fascinating thing to me, because I never saw anybody get healed in the churches, but I prayed for everyone. Yeah. And people always felt better when they came to my office, and they always unloaded all their problems, and I would always, you know. But I got so sick of being the unpaid counselor at the church. I never saw anything really truly happen, except they felt better for a short time, and then my line would grow longer, and I was over it, you know. I wasn't on pastoral staff because we had no women on pastoral staff, and I thought, I'm an administrator. Why are there lines of people waiting to get in my office? This is, you know, but I understand now what was happening there.
Right.
But so I went to this Baptist Western Seminary, which was very close to our church, and laid on the floor. I couldn't sit, you know. I used to type on my stomach, and I mean, just the weirdness of God to prompt me to go do that, because I was trying to find a solution to the lines of people trying to get into my office to talk to me. Mm-hmm. And they had this faith coaching program, which was basically executive coaching dialed into, you know, use it in your church, and all these pastors were in this master's program. So I was like, man, I'm going to go learn how to do that. I'm not a pastor, but if I can learn how to do that, I can get rid of these people in this line.
Okay.
So I went, I did that for 2.5 years, and everything I learned. And then I thought, well, I can just coach people on the phone. I can lay down and do that. And that's going to be income for my family. My husband lost his job at that time. It was crazy. And so I did that did executive coaching of some very big companies and things like that. But I still kept my job at the church. And then the weirdest thing, after I got healed, the Lord, right before I got healed in April, he gives me a word and says, go to VOA. And then he tells me not to do any more coaching. I can hear the Lord, but, you know, I mean, it was exponentially increased at VOA. But at that time, I could hear the Lord. And he said, I want you not. I said, are you kidding me? No, I worked so hard to do this. And this is great income for my, he goes, no, I don't want you to do that. Well, I didn't know I was about to get healed. And I didn't know everything was just going to like take off like a rocket. So being in Randy's school, having a background in a conservative seminary, gave me enough theological foundation in the spirit through Randy's school and through the word, and then through my theological training at Western Seminary to go out and start doing. But I'm a learner, I'm a digger, and now I'm back in back in Randy's seminary yet again.
I forgot. No, you are.
So I'm back in that. Just
you're actually ahead of me.
I am barely. I think
I'm gonna catch back up.
You are. We're going
to take a year off.
Graduate together. Wouldn't that be fun?
It would be great.
That would be so
fun. I was going to try to graduate with Jess, but she's a freak.
She, you know.
Yeah.
She's a fast tracker.
Yeah, what a weirdo.
I don't know.
I don't know. She has too much free time.
Yeah,
she's brilliant.
She's a machine. So anyway, all that to say is I wouldn't have stepped out into all of this having no understanding.
Right.
And I knew I would get eaten alive theologically if I didn't have a basis. So I was really grateful. Randy and Randy Clark, Rodney Hogue, Blaine Cook were all, especially Rodney Hogue and Blaine Cook. I traveled with Blaine for 4 years and they taught me a ton.
Yeah.
And helped me. Rodney helped me so much theologically. I mean, he's got a doctorate and his Baptist roots and stuff like that. So I feel like between that school, the seminary and the mentors that I had at least enough, stuff that, I mean, not that I wasn't intimidated and freaked out and felt like every day was jumping off the cliff.
Right.
You know, it was a lot of trust.
Yeah.
The first time I was asked to go overseas, I think I was healed barely a year And I got asked to speak in an Anglican church. And I walked in that Anglican church and had flashbacks of my Catholic upbringing and thought, I'm not allowed to be in here, you know, as a female. Right. And I got totally intimidated, didn't know that was spiritual. I just felt like, I can't do this. And I'm not a nervous person. I'm pretty confident.
Yeah.
But the vicar came over to me and he said, what is going on with you? And I just, I'm not highly emotional either, but I had tears. And I said, man, I shouldn't be here. Mm. And he looks at me and he says, the mantle that God has put on me for the Anglican church, I put that on you right now. I was a completely spirit-filled guy. And from that moment, it was like something broke off of me. Wow. Having somebody who was in authority spiritually say, no, God is the one who sent you here. Yeah. And that's happened to me over and over and over again in different arenas.
I watch you go into the craziest places. You've been...
Holy cow.
I mean, 10 years? Mm-hmm. The open doors that you have literally blow my mind.
It's nuts.
It is. And it's everywhere you go, I watch you just... It's like I'll be going to a place and they're like, oh, yeah, we know Joe. We've known her for 6 years. She's been... I'm like, what? I've been praying to get into a place like that. You know, like, Lord, give me a platform like this. They're like, oh, yeah, Joe, we've known her. Yeah.
Get out.
Yeah, it really is crazy. Like, you, the open doors that you have are mind-boggling.
I think that people ask all the time, well, how do you get that? I never wanted that. I never wanted to do ministry. I can't tell you. And ministry was never in my top 10, my top 100 of things to do with my life. But I said to the Lord, you can have my life. If you came upon me and healed me of this horrid, horrid disease. And here I am.
Yeah.
What would I do without you? I didn't expect him to use me in this way. And I still don't. I'm literally shocked. Every time I get an invitation to do something, I'm always thinking, what? I don't know.
I was just sitting, I was like, man, the Joe, I've known her, you know, I've known you for a while now, much better these last few years. And I was thinking about you, and I really think that you carry something very similar to Randy, but also very similar to John Wimber, where you teach, train, and equip, raise up.
That's very kind. Thank you.
And you give it away. And everywhere I go, it's like, oh, I'm on her team. I'm on her team. I'm on Joe's team. I'm like, what the heck? Like, we got, I think we have like, Iris has 400 missionaries. I'm like, I think Joe has a bigger team than almost anyone. You've been raising up, equipping, encouraging, mentoring people.
Yeah.
What do you see the Lord doing right now with the equipping of the saints? Because I think you're doing it in a different way. It's free. For a lot of people, it's like a club or like an internship. When I get around the people that you're raising up, it's like family.
They are
family. And it's almost like there's no sign here, do this. Mm-hmm. It's like, come with me on this trip. Mm-hmm. How many people are you like equipping right now?
We're over 140 now that are trained ministry team. We also have pastoral partners that, I mean, they run big churches, they run big ministries, and they just want to go on a trip for fun.
Right.
So we have them. But I'm not like Randy. I don't have the grace, like Pat Bach, to take strangers on mission trips. So we have people all the time who are like, hey man, can I come with you? And I'm like, nope, go with Randy. Because the DNA, it's not a cult, it's not a club, it is family.
Yeah.
I mean, because I went to seminary and learned how to do all this team building, that's what this is. This is that when God said, lay down the coaching, then he said, pick it up again and make it discipleship. So it was wild how all of that wasn't taught for discipleship at the time in the seminary. But when I started this whole ministry, because God said, start this nonprofit, I was like, why? I'm not going to be doing anything. Yeah. I mean, just shock, follow God and be obedient and just watch what happens. And so when he said, do this, and now I want you to give it all away and then teach them how to give it away, the entire model of everything that is Agape Freedom Fighters is from that seminary, which didn't even believe in the Holy Spirit. Yeah. I mean, I just think it's hilarious. And so the team runs super tight. If you went to India with us, or you went to Istanbul with us, or you went to the UK with us, even though different people will be on the trip, the DNA will be the same.
Yeah.
And they're all, I mean, they have to go through a lot of training with us, and we try to make sure people are decently healed up. I mean, we're all in a process, but we don't, you know, I want to have fun.
Yeah.
I'm all about fun and no drama. And we don't have a lot of that. I think in almost 10 years now, we've had three ministry altercations in 10 years.
That's a miracle.
That's staggering. That is a total miracle. And we've wished them well and blessed them and sent them on. But we don't have that. And it's not that we don't have robust discussions but we don't bring in people just like us either. This is all about how you share value systems for the kingdom. This is about how you get, you know, everyone's got personal values. I know one of your great values is freedom and the other one's fun. And so if for some reason Iris becomes a drag over a week, couple of weeks period, you're going to find ways to get those values honored somewhere else, because you're always about fun and you're always about freedom. So you, Will Hart, you're going to go find fun and freedom somewhere if Iris becomes really difficult in a season. I know you. I'm the same person, right? So the values of the ministry, and I go around the world and teach this, and I teach so much leadership development, and our school online has a whole year of this, where you're training people up to understand who God made them to be and how to actually honor their personal values and how to get those met outside of the ministry so they don't demand that those personal values be honored in the ministry.
Yeah.
It's a game changer.
Yeah.
And we teach people, if one of your values is competition, go find some place to get that met outside of the ministry. Otherwise, you'll come in and try to take the team down. It's just, there's a lot of dynamics to all this stuff.
Yeah.
So the team itself, they're tremendous. And we have we have lawyers, we have people that stay home and take care of kids, we have teachers, we have doctors, we have the gamut.
Right.
And they all just love Jesus, and they all just want to see the gospel brought in power to the ends of the earth. And so
you really truly have this group of like, hey, let's just go and do it. And it's you're not, it doesn't become a thing. It's not about the ministry. It's about going and serving and loving. I was cleaning my wife's, she's at a clinic right now getting treatment, and I took it upon myself to clean our bedroom.
And how'd that go, Will?
Amazing.
Really good. Spotless?
Oh, it's actually, I did a good job. But I was digging through a bunch, you know, during the season, a lot of people sent a lot of things and blankets and things, you know, for her treatment.
Yeah.
And I came across a pile with one of the letters that your team wrote. I think it was back in December. And it was about two or three pages of words from your team.
Yeah. So I asked them to just send prophetic words to Moose.
Yeah. And I think I'm in there.
Yeah.
At least the ones that I read.
You're in there in all of them.
And I've been reading through them. It's on my bedside table even right now.
Cool.
And I've been reading through them over and over again. They're incredible.
Mm-hmm.
The team that you're raising up is incredible.
Oh, thank you.
Really,
praise
really
God
incredible.
For that.
And just accurate and encouraging.
And most of them came out of cessationist background, which I find fascinating.
I find cessationism absolutely fascinating. I do. I find it fascinating. And it's amazing. I've been in conversations with the director of American Gospel.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we've been talking about
cessationism. No controversy there.
Listen, I love that.
It's all great.
I love
We have to discuss
and
it.
And I love the body. Yeah. And we're gonna have disagreements as long as they're secondary issues.
Yeah.
But it's amazing how controversial a move of God is and the Holy Spirit moving is. And I've really enjoyed my conversation with Brandon, and we disagree, but it's funny. He came from a charismatic background, more of a spirit-filled
background. We were talking
background.
About this the other night. Yeah. You went the opposite,
and
he went
Calvinist. I don't think he's a cessationist. Brandon, if you're listening, I'm not trying. I love you, dude. I have tons of respect for you, man.
But he's still discovering. He's just trying to figure out.
Yeah, we filmed right here for his movie, and he came from the spirit filled and went more, cessationist or Calvinist. Yep. And then I went from Calvinist to the spirit filled realm.
And that had to be a robust dialogue.
It's great. And I love it because it's his walk and his journey with the Lord.
Absolutely.
Right. And there are things that I've dabbled in that are not the Lord that I call the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the way it is in every camp.
Yeah.
But the cessationist, Randy, when I was traveling with Randy, Randy was always talking about cessationism. I was like, what are you even talking about? Like, Randy, let's just do this stuff. But as I've gotten older, I've really started to value that take, because we have all these brothers and sisters out there that we disagree with. I mean, you came from a church And it didn't go well when the Lord healed you. Nope. But there are brothers and sisters in Christ. And we got to find a way. We really have to find a way to meet in the middle. I think some of the spirit-filled people need to lay down some of their golden calves.
Yeah, there's
because we have a lot of them. Do have a lot of them.
Yeah.
And we have something to learn from our brothers. And they need to let go and let go of the control. What concerns me about cessationism is when you have an answer for everything, when you literally can just answer everything, you have it all figured out. Yeah. And there's mystery.
I had an interesting thing happen about maybe 3 months ago. I had was praying. So my face, and I had this visitation from the Lord happen in my office. And I saw something come down in front of me. And this does not happen often, so I was paying attention to this. So for those of you who think that this is, you know, whacked, this is like having a dream, but I'm awake, I'm praying. So it's an open vision, I have this thing, and down from the heavens comes this scale in front of me. And I was like, what is that? That's so beautiful. It was solid gold. And it was a huge scale. And the plates that you would weigh the things on, one side said mystery and one side said majesty. Mm. And along the base of this huge thing, it said power and authority. Yeah. And I was like, I don't understand what this is. And then the Lord said, look closer. And the whole centerpiece that comes up, and it's the arch, right? So if you can imagine what a scale looks like, it's the round base. Yeah. There's the center pole. Like the arm that comes above that holds the scales, right? So along the center point is Jesus engraved up the center. And then the arms are holding the scales, and that says Holy Spirit. So imagine this. The base is power and authority. The scales are majesty and mystery. Jesus is the center always. And then it's Holy Spirit. And the Lord said this to me. He said, if you do not learn to navigate the tension in this next season between mystery and majesty, you will not understand how to be caught up in my spirit and help lead. You will drag people down.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to hold on to what I used to know as being, this is the only way God comes, or I'm going to be sunk when he comes in a different way, and I don't understand that. There's such a tension between the mystery of God and the majesty of God. And he said, when you don't understand what I'm about to do, then let my majesty overtake you.
Come on.
And I thought, that is such a word for right now. And just after that, then Asbury broke out, right?
Yeah.
So this maybe was about 2 months ago. So when Asbury broke out and came, this is the fourth time they've had revival in that on that campus.
Okay.
And the biggest one was in the 1970s.
Yeah.
I find it fascinating that that is a Methodist university and they're conservative.
Yeah.
And I had lots of team there, and I did not go because I was traveling, but one of my team that's super close to me was there every day because that team member happens to live 5 minutes from Asbury. And reported to me that there could be no demonstrative. There was no flagging. There was no... And you went, right?
I did. So actually, I did drugs there when I was like 15. My sister went to that college.
Did you go when before they shut it down? Meetings?
Yeah, I went Jess, on like the last Jess day with Jess. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. My kids.
So you experienced the
that was when I was drugs, 15. My sister went to school
not
there.
The drugs. And, okay, yeah.
So I went out in my heyday. Yeah.
But you experienced the way God rolled in there was gentleness, repentance, beautiful. Gentle.
I thought it was incredible. And I have positioned my life to the best of my ability to wherever I hear the Lord is moving. Yes. Like, I want to be there.
Yeah.
I don't want to say I chase anything, but like, I honestly, if God's moving, if you that's a church, if that's in my house, if that's in my kids' lives, I want to be there and I want to be around. I want to watch God move.
Yeah.
It's
fun.
Watching the Lord do something is so beautiful in the lives of others. There's nothing like it when you see people getting transformed by his word, by his grace, by his love, by his power. There's few things that are as beautiful as that.
I agree.
And so I want to be around
and
any of it. And it's caused me to go all around the globe. Mm-hmm. I wanted to go up to Asbury, but because the way my life is right now, I was like, I can't. Yeah. But I was watching. And then my kids came to me and said they wanted to go. Wow. And that was massive. I was like, yes.
Let's
okay.
go.
Because that's not something that you would hear. You know my kids really well. They're not like, please, meetings, you know. But they wanted to go. And that was just a sign to me. And I went and sat there. And it was so pure.
Mm-hmm. That's the word everybody, I had over 60 friends that went and mm-hmm. they said this, that's the word they all used.
It was just precious. Mm-hmm. It was beautiful. Mm-hmm. Listen, I don't think I'd call it revival. No. That's just me. But
it was an outpouring.
Yeah, I just think it was awesome. Like it was beautiful. It was, the Lord was moving nonstop. Yeah. In people's lives, and it continued on. I don't have to put a label of it on it.
It's good.
I think revival is told in the history books, mm-hmm. right? You don't have to.
That's the after.
Right. Yeah. But whatever, like it doesn't matter. Call it whatever you want. Call it church. Yeah. It doesn't matter. God was moving. Mm-hmm. And you have to be really, you have to like harden your heart to really, in my opinion, to judge these kids, because there's a lot. I also heard like a lot of the judgment stuff.
It was so raw and it was so beautiful. And we had a similar outpouring at a church in Pennsylvania the week before Asbury was stopped. Mm-hmm. A young youth pastor, she's 25 and she's leading Gen Zs, 16 to 20.
Oh yeah.
And she's at Christ Community Church in Pennsylvania. But she had driven from Asbury at 3 a.m. and the morning I was to speak at that church. And she goes up to share about her testimony of having been there. And the power of the Lord falls on this woman. She can't even speak. And I wasn't introduced yet or anything, but I'm standing there I'm like watching the Lord about to just blow through.
Yeah.
If we would just call everyone who is in that generation, Gen Zers, up to the front.
Yeah.
So I just turned to the associate pastor. I go, can I run up there? Like, you haven't introduced by anything. He goes, go ahead. Went up there and she just fell out right then when I walked up there. But I put the microphone to her mouth and I said, you have to call them. Call them to come up right now. So she can't hardly speak, but she calls them all to come forth. And I said, and call the generations to support them. Mm. And everybody in the church came forward. And there was this very similar to Asbury, this pure, most beautiful repentance of, I've judged generations on either side of me. I don't understand how to communicate with them. But there was a unification that happened, which I believe is what was the beginning of what was happening at Asbury. I wouldn't call it revival. I would call it God being kind and merciful, getting our attention to say, what is the most important thing? Come back to purity, come back to repentance, come back to me. And watch what I'll do if you'll just unify and lay down your, you know, God only comes if there's fire. God only comes when we're flagging. God only comes if we don't do the flagging and we don't. I mean, it's these hard walls that we put up against God saying you can come like this, but you can't come like that on both sides of the fence, on the charismatic and the cessationism side.
It was beautiful. You watch a room full of 20-year-olds worshiping. I think they said they did something like 280 hours. I don't know the exact number. But what
it was. It was beautiful, though. I watched it.
It was beautiful. It was just beautiful. Where that people had issues with certain things, and it's like, man, let the Lord work on people's hearts. If there is anything, like, let the Lord work on people's hearts. You can't force that. The Holy Spirit does that.
Yeah.
I heard repent. Dylan was with me. Dylan's sitting off camera. We heard people say the word repent like 30 times.
Yeah.
In an hour.
Yeah.
Like the gospel was preached, testimonies were given, and lives were transformed.
And the healings were gentle. I mean, they happened, but they weren't like this what we're used to. We're used to, you know, it's this mighty, mighty outpouring of power. It was power, but it just came in a different way. I find it really interesting. The guy who was preaching when the Lord rolled in, his name is Zach. And he's very close friends with our...
Because you know everybody.
It's
the weirdest thing.
It's
but anyway.
My amazing administrator, who I adore with all my heart, Kelsey, she's very close because she lives right there. But Zach, she said, you know, I went back. We just talked yesterday. She goes, I went back and I listened to Zach's message. And she said, I was trying to see, okay, what was it that he said?
I watched the same thing.
And she said, I listened to it again. And she said, you know something, Joe? It wasn't the most riveting preach I ever heard. She said, and I absolutely loved Zach.
Yeah.
It was this one thing. He said, what we really need is a baptism, or what you really need is a baptism of the Father's love. That's what he said. Yeah. And it was those words. He didn't say it like, what? You know, he wasn't like in a certain, he just said it.
Yeah.
And the minute he said that,
yeah,
enrolled the Holy Spirit, yeah, in a way they haven't seen since, yeah, the 70s. And what an odd thing. Now everybody's examining it, trying to figure out. The thing I love the most is the fruit of an outpouring, like the fruit of the whole entire thing, is even though everybody's critical that they shut it down. I mean, hey, most people who are critical about them shutting it down didn't spend day and night there for
I'm not critical of it at all. I think,
yeah, I think they're
smart.
It ended up causing a ton of hungry, passionate people to start their own moves, yeah, in their own cities, which is exactly what they said would happen if they shut it down. And, yeah, that's been beautiful to watch.
You said it was about the love of the Father, mm-hmm, or the heart of the Father. Mm-hmm. And I've shared my testimony. I'm sure anybody watching this has heard it. But like, my first encounter was not with power. It was powerful. But the first moments, it was love. That was the first thing.
You needed your, yeah, heart healed. We all.
And as soon as I had never encountered that, love like that.
Yeah.
And we can get all earthy, hippy, crunchy, mm-hmm, with like love and peace and, you know, but like, I didn't know how loved I was.
Yeah.
Right. And when I felt that in my sin, in my,
yeah,
disgusting filth, which I was swimming in,
yeah,
when I felt love, regardless of where I was at, it changed everything. Yeah. And it opened me up to go, God, I want more.
Yeah.
I want more.
Yeah.
And as soon as I asked for more is when the power of God fell on me. And I just want him, right? And when I went up there, yeah, and I saw this, I just saw kids crying out for him. There was two, like, I don't know, they must have been 15, 16-year-olds standing behind us. Maybe they're, I don't know. It's hard to tell. they looked about the same age as my kids. Just weeping, you know, in the presence. No one was praying for him. We prayed for them because they asked us, turn around and pray for the people next to you. But they were just weeping. Just real, real precious time. Those moments are so transformational. And I loved it.
What'd your kids say?
You know, why you gotta ask me that? They didn't come back. They weren't like, oh, this was amazing. But my son was like, Dad, I want to maybe look at going to the school.
Wow.
Right? So you know, that's my oldest. And he doesn't like me talking about him. So I probably won't go too much further than that. But
that's cool.
I saw it as an ongoing piece of a work that God's doing, yeah, in his life. They didn't leave going, oh, this is amazing, but they don't have to. I don't need every meeting they go to be a barn burner. No. For me, the fact that they wanted to go was precious, and
they got to be in it. I mean,
yeah.
God's the great multiplier.
Some amazing stuff happened there. In fact, I had Riley, who's a mutual friend. She went up, I think, day three or day four with, yeah, Jess, and something really neat happened to her.
Right.
And actually, I got a phone call 3 days ago from Dr. Craig Keener.
Oh, who's, I always wanted to meet him.
Theologian, yeah, at Asbury Seminary. And while we were there, we met with him, and we told him what happened to Riley, and he got like super excited. For me, it seemed like this normal little thing, but Riley's a worship leader. She,
yes,
got. She was there just in the crowd, yeah, worshiping on the floor, and like people came up to her. I think some of the leaders came up to her and were like, you're a worship leader, mm-hmm, aren't you? She's like, yep. Mm-hmm. And she actually ended up leading,
yeah,
worship for
2.5 hours.
2.5 hours. They pulled her up. So we told that to Dr. Craig. He was like, what? They wouldn't do that, you know? But, and they connected. Riley shared last night with us a little bit of the story. She came over for my son's birthday party, and she shared a little bit of the story. But there's all these teeny little things that God did in the middle of it. And I think that's what's so beautiful. They weren't forced. So whether it was my, yeah, kids and maybe something small the Lord deposited in their heart, or like Riley going up and being called out. And it actually, I didn't have the time because it was late, but I think it shifted something in her. Like it healed something in her. She hadn't been used in maybe worship
time.
In a long time.
Time.
And, mm-hmm, it was almost like the Lord was like, I'm, yeah, on you. I got this. She didn't share too much of that, but she said something very deep happened to her in that moment. Those are the moments.
That's phenomenal.
You can't, I've never seen revival fall in a revival service, right? Mm-mm. You can't orchestrate the stuff.
No.
But when the Lord's moving and people gather and, mm-hmm, worship, anything can happen. And I think your healing, anything can happen, right? Voice of the Apostles. Yeah. Listen, we only have a few minutes left, and I can talk to you for a while. But I also know we have a schedule. And I want to make sure you have a call soon. Listen, people, if they want to get in contact, if they want to find out more information, where can they go?
They can check out our social media at Rev Joanne Moody.
Rev Joanne Moody. Rev Joanne Moody. Who picked that one out for you?
Well, you know, I had something else, and then, you know, it's a long story.
What did you have?
You don't need, no,
I want to hear it.
Never mind. Long ago and far away.
Okay.
And they can check out our website
and
check out our school. That's all Agape Freedom Fighters or Agape Life School.
There. And a few months ago, you just published a book.
Did. Was this your first? Second one. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Everyday Supernatural is out and about. And that actually is a super fun read because it is the everyday person who loves Jesus, who just wants to see the world changed. And it's full of biblical teaching, but full of testimonies of people doing just that. And then the end of the chapter is prayers. You pray with the Lord for yourself. And then there is a challenge at the end of every chapter. How are you going to give it away? To Matthew 10, 7 and 8. It has to be, you know, I think that there are too many bored Christians, and nobody should be bored, because actually life with him is so enjoyable. He is, God is the most amazing best friend anybody could ever have. And he's always got something new and incredibly creative for people. So I, you know, as long as I'm can be utilized in any way, I want to be just equipping everybody who's younger than me to go out and, you know, be that answer.
Come on.
And be that change. It's an exciting time.
Your teams, like you said, are so multifaceted. You got lawyers and doctors and kids and students, moms and
students.
Yeah, it's like everything in between. What would you say to somebody who's nervous about jumping in, stepping out? You know, they look at someone like yourself. They're like, of course she can do this. Look at her. She's like this dynamic, you know, confident. Right.
Yeah. But
what would you say to somebody who doesn't feel that way?
I think I learned the most from Blaine Cook, who traveled with John Wimber. And John Wimber always said that, you know, the growth is spelled R-I-S-K. Mm-hmm. And if you're not willing to risk and you're not willing to be wrong, you're not willing to, you know, to make mistakes, then you won't do it.
Yeah.
And it's, you could ask anyone on our team, they'll tell you they've had to do some terrifying things, terrifying to one's ego, terrifying in people who love calculated things and really aren't risk takers, people who are like, I really need to have all the information. And we practiced a lot for the person who says, I don't think I can do that. Try one thing.
Yeah.
If you prayed in the morning and said, God, just use me today to bring honor to one person, or God, use me today to bring love to one person. And ask God to speak through you. And I always tell people, you don't have to have like the most right on crazy, ultra prophetic word to be relevant. Just be kind. I mean, we don't even see kindness so much anymore. I mean, we do in the South, which I love Tennessee. I love Thank you so much. But just going out and being kind. It's interesting what happens with people who are learning. God will often not give you everything, because he wants you to rely on him and walk with him. And if you get an inkling about somebody, like let's say you walk into Starbucks, because everyone does, and you walk in there and you look around and you ask this simple thing, Holy Spirit, who do you want to touch in this place? And I know that, you know, you do that all the time. I do it all the time. But it never gets like super comfortable. I still feel super awkward.
Yep.
But every time. I usually say to the person, hey, can I share something with you? It's just a simple, can I share something with you?
Yeah.
I don't keep them very long. And I'll share it, and they'll, if it lands, if it's something that's relevant to them, they'll be like, how'd you know that? And I always say these words, I'm just practicing hearing God. And I always make sure that they feel loved. So if you're trying to grow in this and you're like, oh, I can't do it, practice with one thing and practice with kindness first.
Yeah.
Walking up and saying, looking in somebody's eyes and saying, you know, God really loves you, and I'm praying for you right now that your day is amazing. Sometimes I go into places and I go, I just did this yesterday. I'm praying all your customers today are not jerks. I mean, that's not like a super prophetic word. I could have prophesied over those two women standing there, but I didn't think they would receive it. All they needed was someone to listen to them about all of their terrible customers, and they were like, man, I hope you come back. It wasn't a great revelatory come to Jesus meeting, but it was something that looks like kingdom.
Yeah.
And that is love and kindness. And I think people need, you need to be willing to be wrong, because you will be wrong from time to time. The last thing I'll say about that is, we teach our teams all the time, in the moment when you say, God, use me, and you are willing to risk, and you release whatever this little impression is that you have mm-hmm. for somebody, and you're right, it lands, pay attention to how you're physically feeling, where your mind was, because if you understand how you think and how you feel in the moment when God lands on you to give something, you'll be right more often. People don't pay attention to that stuff, and it makes a big, big difference. I don't prophesy super accurately if I'm completely concentrating on where I am in the moment. Yeah. I have to be a little bit, and you do too. I have to be checked out. I'm kind of distracted, and the best, most accurate prophetic words are when I'm distracted. And people always go, are you looking at me? I usually look away and out, because I'm just communing with God in an atmosphere that isn't right here in that present yeah. moment. If I'm trying really hard, it doesn't work. So I've had to learn that. I've had to learn that just through trial and error and being wrong. And yeah, and it's so fun to be part of somebody's great story.
You said trial and error, being wrong.
What was my great missing it? You know, well, here's a redemption one. I'll tell you this quick story.
Yeah.
So one of my spiritual sons, he's having a baby with his wife, and he comes up to me, and he's so stinking prophetic. He's like one of the most prophetic young guys we have on our team. And he walks up, he goes, hey, Joe, so do you know what we're having? And I go, yeah, you're having a boy. And he goes, you're wrong. And I look at him, and I was like, wow. I go, okay, I'm wrong. Wow. I said, okay, man, sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't get it. His wife was standing there laughing. They had just had a sonogram, and the baby was a girl. And I get in the car, and I'm driving away because I just finished preaching at this church, and they were going one way, I was going another. I get in the car, I go, wow, Lord, that was weird, because I know you said they're having a boy. And the Lord's quiet. And I'm like, wow, I'm really sorry I missed that, because that meant I really wasn't hearing you. So, wow, that was lame, and I'm super sorry, I said to the Lord. And then I was driving home, like, okay, let it go. You know, I let it go, worshiping. I get in the door, and then I said to the Lord one more time, man, I just don't get it, because, like, I know how you speak. I heard you. Okay, but I'm just going to let it go. The next day, I get a text from Aaron, and he goes, get out of here, Joe Moody. He goes, we had to go back to the doctor because they missed it. He said, we are not having a girl. We're having a boy. And I went, that's right. Giddy up.
I love it. I asked you for a story about when you get it wrong, and you gave me one when you got it right. Okay, no, I'm just kidding. No,
I have gotten many wrong.
I love it. I love that.
But that one was hilarious. Well,
I know we got to end, but like, that's actually a thing. And I don't want to, like, there's so many times when people are like, you're wrong. That's not what's happening.
Totally.
And I will repent.
I apologize. I say, I'm so sorry.
I hate that.
Yeah.
Because you never want to. You never want to misrepresent what you feel like the Lord is sharing with you.
No, and I never push that. If people say that is absolutely not right, I go, I am so sorry. I am just practicing. You know, let me just pray for you, and I'll just shut my mouth.
That's and every so often you get one of those people that are like a couple of years later, like, remember that time? You said, yeah, it happened.
But humility is the best discourse.
And I just go, Lord, thank you that I'm right. No, I'm
sorry. Which is why I just told you that story.
Walking in the prophetic is very scary.
It's
for me
super scary.
And I think
you're super good at it, because you're very humble the way that you approach it.
Do you know what I do now? I say, I think the Lord is saying this, or I feel like the Lord is saying this. I have an impression. Yep. And I put it flat out from the beginning. I said, and I say this, and I've had people that have corrected me on this, but they're wrong. I'm not a prophet.
I don't think
you don't like it, but I say this. I say this, and let me tell you why. Okay. Right? Like, I think the prophetic has.
I know where you're going.
I think we do need to be careful.
Yep.
And as much of as I do listen to, like, our other brothers and sisters, right, that might disagree, a lot of the stuff that they point to is the inaccuracy. And a lot of the hurt that's come through, that's come through the movement. And like, listen, we can all cry over spilled milk, but I think we do have to be like, okay, there is some unhealthiness. I'm not going to point at a person.
Well, no.
But like, I think the pendulum swings far on both sides, right?
Absolutely.
And I think we do need to listen and be like, hey, we do need to be really humble when we are sharing. this is what the Lord is saying, like, or this is what I think the Lord is saying. Like, that's actually a big deal
yeah.
for someone that might not be in a healthy place. Now, yeah. I know when we're with friends or they're in our yeah. stream, like, we can be a little bit more free because mm-hmm. they have a healthy understanding of mm-hmm. what's taking place. But I've tried to be like, I think the Lord is saying this. Mm-hmm. I was praying for you, I had this impression on my heart.
Yeah, that's exactly the language.
And just try to give it a little bit more softness. And yeah. I said, I'm not a prophet, but I want to share some things that when I was praying for you came to my heart, and do with them what you want. And I don't know, Joe, like, I think I never want to like course correct.
Well,
out of fear, right?
But I don't think it was out of fear. I think it's necessary, but I also know that we can course correct to such a degree where yep. we throw it out again. And
yeah. And that's
dangerous. I think that's dangerous. Yeah. There's got to be a way of walking this line respectfully. Yeah. I mean, I go to, just like you, I go to tons of denominations mm-hmm. where this is new for them. I mm-hmm. mean, we just trained Catholic clergy in August in Rwanda, which yeah. that's unheard of. Yeah. And that this was all new for them.
Yeah.
So when I'm at the bishop there, there's language you would, yeah. you have yep. to use the language that is respectful without... Right. You know, I don't want to add injury to people's lives. I just want to be love. I think that's the bottom line. If yeah. you can, you know, I don't know who said it. Maybe it was Sean Bowles or somebody said, you don't have authority over that thing you don't love.
Yeah.
And if a person becomes your next prophetic project,
yeah.
and there's a lot of people who can't go in a room and not prophesy. Yeah. I think that measure of self-restraint and where is God moving? I mean, I try to. I don't always succeed for sure, but I try to ask God, you know, if you have something pressing, then tell me.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'm going to try to yield to what's happening with you and what's happening in the room, because God yeah. He's an all-inclusive God. He actually wants everyone to know him. Yeah. So I don't want to cause offense, but I also don't want to shrink back yeah. either. I mean,
one last story, because and then we do need to end.
Go.
When we were buying our house here in Franklin.
Yes.
You gave me a word about the house. Mm-hmm. I felt that it was what was resonating in my heart.
Yeah.
I think you were one of the only ones that was like, it's going to happen. You're going to get the mm-hmm. house. And I stood on that thing. And in the middle of it looking like it was going
to
fall apart.
We drove up to mm-hmm. it. And I remember you said, hey, can we go to the house? We drove up to it. And the Lord, I remember, you know, and if you weren't who you were, I would say I had an impression. Yeah. I had a yep. really strong impression.
Yeah.
Your family will live here.
Yep.
But I said to you, the Lord said, because I heard it. I heard it in my head. I heard it mm-hmm. in my heart.
Yep.
Oh, this will be their house. Not that it wouldn't be a struggle, but the Lord would come through because you had set your sights on this house and you could see your family living there. And you knew yep. that this could be the size, the place, yeah. the neighborhood, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And God wanted you to be safe. And you had such a rocky landing coming here. And I knew.
Wasn't that rocky? Well, but we stayed in Joe's house. It was amazing.
Well, you have to ask your youngest about that.
They're fine.
But I knew.
The carpets cleaned.
I knew that you know, your family is yeah. is the beloved of God. Yeah. And your heart, you know. What is that Job 22:28 where it says you declare a thing and it will happen for you. Yep. And we don't take that lightly. We're not prosperity gospel no. people at all. What we're no. talking about, those in rich relationship with him who are walking, yielded to him, sold yep. out for him. You're like, but God, could I have this house yep. for my family?
Yep.
And you know, God's perfect will prevails always. But there was this massive impression about that house.
Yeah.
And it was a little dodgy.
It was a battle. It shouldn't happen. It happened in the craziest real estate time in this area.
Nuttiest.
In one of the craziest places. And God, and the whole way it happened was last minute yep. by the line. And I don't have time to tell a story, but
testimony.
It's incredible. But I loved your boldness. And I think amongst friends.
Yeah.
Right.
That's
where
cool.
I get you.
And
I've had this conversation with David Wagner, different prophets that I know, like they can share anything with me because I know them, I yeah, love their heart, and I open that up to them.
But you have love, right? Yep. That's the difference. Yep. You might not go up to a stranger in a grocery store,
no,
though
no.
I have. But when it's pressing,
yeah.
when I feel that unction, if I'm not running around looking to prophesy,
yeah.
I'm looking to be surrendered. And I think that's our whole life.
Be surrendered, guys. Listen,
God bless
Joe,
you.
We've gone way over.
We're like 13 hours later, but this podcast was amazing.
And you have something that you need to get to.
I do.
I love you, massive.
I love you.
Thank you for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Go grab her book, check her out on Instagram, and like and subscribe. Share this with somebody because you know it's going to bless them. It blessed me. Amen. Love you.
Love you.
And we'll see you guys on the next
Green Room.
Green Room.
God bless you. Thanks, bud. That was fun.
Yeah, thank you.